And now, the Edwin Black Show. Sponsored by the books of Edwin Black. Available on Amazon and at booksellers worldwide. And now, here's Edwin.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. This is Edwin Black. Thank you very much for joining us. I'm the investigative journalist and historian, the author of IBM and the Holocaust, War Against the Weak, and many other books. My Zoom dashboard has lit up with viewers from across the United States, as well as Great Britain, Israel, Canada, Germany, Mexico, elsewhere. In addition, I thank all of those in schools and elsewhere who are sharing their screen with colleagues, thus multiplying our audience. We hope to include as many of you as possible in today's important, perhaps unforgettable episode. If you have a question limited to today's topic, place it in Zoom's QA feature, or email me, ask@theedwinblackshow.com. We already have quite a few, probably 36. The Edwin Black Show is growing and growing globally. We speak to a fragmented world, seeking better understanding of our tormented past, our present tense, and our future, still undecided. We are an all-volunteer group across many cities here in several countries. If you possess skills and talents and wish to join us, go to join the team at theedwinblackshow.com. Also, we ask all of our viewers to subscribe at our YouTube channel at The Edwin Black Show and hit that notify button. After this episode, our production team will add all sorts of graphics to create a highly enhanced rendition of this episode. So get over to the YouTube channel and subscribe to The Edwin Black Show and hit the notify button. Now, just a few show notes. We had an unexpectedly successful show last week. That is the Ask Me Anything episode. We went a long way, but we could not get to all the questions that were posed worldwide. Maybe we did half of them. I've been roundly encouraged to do more, and we will, but narrower, limited to specific topics. So you'll start seeing those about once a month. Now to our topic, Tarnished Icons. This topic is so enormous, we could and will do a series of examinations in various successive episodes. We have all seen the statues being torn down, vandalized, or threatened. Confederate generals, Christopher Columbus, Thomas Jefferson, George Washington, and even such figures as Frederick Douglass, plus the 72-hour period when television's longest-running TV show, Cops, cable's biggest TV franchise, Live PD, and one of Hollywood's most enduring motion pictures, Gone with the Wind, were all erased from their place in the entertainment world. Add to that the rapid subtraction of Aunt Jemima, Uncle Ben, Mrs. Butterworth, and Eskimo Pie, and don't forget the soon-to-be-revised name of the Washington Redskins and the Cleveland Indians. In addition, we saw the removal by Princeton of Woodrow Wilson's name from its famous public policy school, and we are witnessing a destructonymic profusion of name removals from colleges, high schools, and public squares. What does this all mean? We are witnessing something that is vastly more significant than the cancel culture of rapid-fire blacklisting for simple utterances, past or present, but something more profound, the actual wholesale re-terraforming of our cultural and historical landscape. Our question today, who in history deserves to be dethroned, which statues should stay and which should go and where. Plus, perhaps more importantly, who decides and how. To me, this is deeply personal. This may be a sudden flash of light for the woken class, who suddenly unsealed their sleepyhead eyes to discover a tarnished legacy behind an iconic monument on a brand name or a prestigious nameplate. But for me, this is my life. 52 years of waking people up in books, articles, lectures, research into corporate files and government records that only begins when I hear the word no, standing up to the corporate attorneys and PR firms, bought and paid for historians, devoting every waking hour of the last century to excavating, extricating, and illuminating the dark side of history, to raise a torch, to light a future, so we can look George Santa Anna in the eye and reply, don't worry, when he reminds us, those who cannot remember the past are condemned to repeat it. You think Christopher Columbus should be mocked. The woken, shaken and only recently stirred woken class is like a Columbus on every street corner. The woken class suddenly discovered a society, a nation, indeed a world, and a human race that, yes, has risen to new heights of wondrous achievement, full of promise and vision, but with blood on its hands, bones embedded beneath its heels, and haunting facts scraped from its memories. I don't have time on one 60-minute show to enumerate the nightmare of history that bites at me daily and has only now begun to nibble at the slow wokes, slow pokes, and slow jokes who have just discovered that, among other things, our great President Woodrow Wilson was an unrepentant and hateful racist while in office who used the White House to undo gains made after the Civil War by resegregating the federal government, helping to propel the rebirth of the KKK, and overseeing an administration which believed, to use his own words given to black employees, segregation is not humiliating but a benefit and ought to be so regarded by you gentlemen. While he was doing this at home, Wilson became a savior to everyone else overseas, the deus ex machina of peace, decency, and self-determination. He helped end World War I, saving millions of lives after millions had already been killed. And he was indispensable to decolonizing the world from European oppressors, inventing the League of Nations, and with it, inventing the modern Middle East, including such brand new countries as Syria, Lebanon, Iraq, Saudi Arabia, Jordan, and eventually Israel. So Wilson is half monster, half humanitarian. Or Christopher Columbus, a lost and frightened mariner who was sailing for India after the Spanish Inquisition had tortured and expelled the Jews and stolen their money, which financed his voyages. His letter to Queen Isabella makes it clear, quote, so after having expelled the Jews from your dominions, your highnesses, in the same month of January, you ordered me to proceed with sufficient armament to the said region of India, close quote. Unbeknownst to him, the Americas were in the way, which then entitled American society to somehow claim he discovered a brand new land that actually had been an ancient continental realm to great indigenous civilizations, hosting a population of many millions, some say as many as 60 millions. As many as 90% of those millions died of European disease and Spanish expansion. So somehow we grew up with the delightful ditty, in 1492, Christopher Columbus sailed the ocean blue. We created Columbus Day, named a big city in Ohio and a big circle in Manhattan for this man who never gave up his mistaken belief that he had reached India. Hence, he called indigenous people on this continent Indians. Caribbean islands became the West Indies. And we all forgot that roughly in the year 990, that is 500 years before Wrong Way Columbus came this way, Leif Erikson and the Vikings actually landed and set up communities just up the street in what is now known as Newfoundland. And by the way, those Viking colonies are now a UNESCO World Heritage Site and a preserved Canadian National Park. Nor do the sleepy ones comprehend that IBM was led by a psychopathic war criminal, Thomas J. Watson, and the company now names its new run-the-world software after him, Watson. That General Motors was led by two main Nazi collaborators. One was an intensely racist Nazi collaborator and fraudster named Alfred Sloan, who made GM a full partner in the Third Reich's war machine, indispensably enabling their takeover of Europe by land, sea, and air. And the other was Charles Kettering, the GM guru that gave us lead and gasoline, knowing it would kill untold numbers of people, as well as Freon and air conditioners that shoot an irreparable hole in the ozone layer. Yet these two men, Sloan and Kettering, responsible for so much death and destruction, so much cancer and other disease, poured enough millions of dollars into a big hospital to create Sloan Kettering Memorial. When money talks, history walks. Or take Ford Motor Company, led by a mechanical genius who is also a mental midget, a gullible and intellectually diminished supreme anti-Semite named Henry Ford. And both he and his company were indispensable to Adolf Hitler's mass murder of 6 million Jews and an equal number of other Europeans and many American soldiers. So I have a lot to say about this topic. This is what I do. For more than a half century, I've devoted myself to documenting the ugly truth about human rights, which have strangely become, for me, inhuman rights. Those who gain status in spite of their true status. The necessary truth needed to continue our wondrous process of expanding the historic circle of entitlement to achieve a greater justice for all continues. If people knew all of this, I wouldn't need to write books. No one would need to tune into this program. What we have here is a failure of history. A total failure, a tear-torn failure of the entire historical structure in the United States, top to bottom. A monstrous, gaping historical hole, which has enabled me to plant an entire career dedicated to educating people who had no idea. First, I blame the teachers, the schools, the colleges, the media, the politicians, all of them. Why did they cultivate generations of Americans without a nuanced knowledge of their world and history? Today, the teachers pretend they are enlightened, but for decades, their students have been endarkened to the facts. Second, I blame an entertainment industry that rewrites history, whitewashes facts, trivializes pain and suffering, and ignores the important tectonic moments in history. The news media is the transfused partner of the entertainment industry, picking and choosing facts and narratives, emphasizing the trivial and minimizing the big stories. Third, I blame the slumber, sleepy-eyed children and their frightened establishmentarians who allowed themselves to sleepwalk through life. Step away from your TikTok, your Twitter, your Facebook, and your cat trick YouTubes long enough to read a book. There are tens of thousands of them. You cannot remake society and history unless you understand society and history, the fuller picture. O ye of the Wikipedia age, drowning in facts, but starved for true knowledge. Learn the word context. Tall trees come from tiny seeds, and weather makes all the difference. I'm not done yet. In all this molten woken, there is an exception to the outrage, an exception to the rule for the woken. It's the Jewish exception. Right now, today, Linda Sarsour can openly denounce Jews in Israel and ally with Louis Farrakhan. A few days ago, Philadelphia Eagles football star DeSean Jackson can tweet out fake Hitler quotes claiming the Jews are a bunch of extortionists. A high school yearbook in Secaucus, New Jersey, suddenly publishes an 88 symbol, which is a global shorthand for Heil Hitler, with H being the eighth letter of the alphabet. Every day across this nation, Jewish and Israel-loving students on campus are harassed, bullied, and vilified because of their Judaism. This goes on every day. What happens? Zero, zip, bupkis. A Jewish leader writes a letter of condemnation. I will get 30 more emails, and someone will pretend to apologize, and then nothing more happens until it happens again. If you want to tear down all the anti-Semitic icons worshipped in this country, you'll have to walk a nameless continent. St. Louis is named for King Louis IX, the only French king to become a saint, but a saint after he ordered on June 17, 1242, the burning of 24 wagon loads with up to 10,000 volumes of handwritten Hebrew manuscripts and Talmudic texts. NBC adulates the Rockefeller Center, named for federally convicted oil gangster John D. Rockefeller, who financed the Nazi doctors and the TWINS program that sent Dr. Mengele into Auschwitz. I suppose Rome, Italy would be renamed after crucifying 6,000 slaves as mile markers along the Appian Way and Jesus Christ in Jerusalem, as well as destroying the Jewish temple, then building the Colosseum with valuables looted from the Jewish temple. That is the wondrous Colosseum where 400,000 men were forced to fight to the death and 1 million animals were cruelly killed in spectacles. And of course, then expelling thousands of Jews from their homeland and bringing them to Rome as slaves. Nope, it's still a great tourist attraction. I was there last year. We don't have enough time to track the crimes, past, present, and future, committing against Jews that still involve in iconic status. But just go to Google and type in Jewish expulsion from, and then wait for the next word. The search engine prompts a long list of cities and countries where Jews were expelled. Take your pick. And if they weren't expelled, perhaps they were just massacred or burned at the stake. Exposing injustice is a full-time employment. But what to do about it? It is complicated and multi-tiered. Do we criminally tear down the statues in angry mobs? No. For many centuries, invaders, mobs, and revolutionaries have attacked cultural icons. In the ancient world, invaders built their temples atop those of the conquered people. When Christianity swept Constantine's world, the pagan temples were converted into Christian churches. When Islam invaded Jewish lands, it built its mosques on the site of the most revered Jewish Holy of Holies in Jerusalem. In 1776, when the American colonists broke away, they tore down the statue of King George, melting the lead to make 42,008 musket bullets to shoot at the British. On May 9, 1933, the Nazi mob burned all the Jewish books. When our troops entered Iraq, the first thing they did was to pull down the statues of Saddam Hussein. Many statues, yes, deserve to come down. I've been saying that for years. But when the mob does it, it's an invasion, a revolution, or plain criminal vandalism. Communities and jurisdictions have a right to re-examine what they have glorified. I've been at the forefront of renaming schools, parks, and museums for their genocidal or racist namesakes. But a violent criminal mob should not decide. Some reviled Churchill for his colonial days. I think he saved humanity from the Nazis and the worst calamity that could ever befall civilization. That means we need discussion. due process and juridical decision. Do it legally. However, there's another crucial dynamic. While it is true we don't want to glorify Confederate generals with larger-than-life statues on a pedestal, never. I don't even know what America was thinking when it elevated these traitors to hero status. We also want to be nuanced. Learn about Churchill. Learn about Franklin D. Roosevelt, who knowingly stood by and watched 6 million Jews perish. Use their mistakes and misdeeds to enrich your life by seeing the error of their ways to light up a more noble path ahead. Understand the bigger picture, and that each picture exemplifies a different thousand-word story. All groups have been persecuted, but life is a highway. To drive it, you need two views at all times, the rearview mirror and the road ahead through the front windshield. Learn to drive the road of life. If you do, we can avoid crashes, these terrible crashes that we have endured. I've said enough, and now I'm going to go to your questions. Okay, so we have so many questions. Let me try to get to them. I've got so many notes here. First, I've got a note from Gloria in Houston. What should be done with the Confederate statues? Okay, when I first came to Washington, D.C. from Chicago, and I saw all these Confederate statues, I could not understand what was going on. I said, these are the traitors to the United States. These are the people who killed their neighbors in the name of slavery. These people inflicted great cruelty. Why should they be honored? So, first off, I would take them down. Second off, if we don't want to throw them in the river, we can perhaps put them in some sort of a Civil War museum, not to be honored at face level, and perhaps in a special place that says, these are the bad guys of American history, and these are the guys who somehow became honored and placed on bigger than life pedestals, but now they have been brought down low, so you may understand them. Similarly, if we go to Auschwitz, we see an important memorial site. We want it preserved. We want to learn about history, but we don't want to see a 20-foot statue of Adolf Hitler or Heinrich Himmler on a pedestal bigger than life, so we can adulate these people. And so they do not deserve to be on a pedestal. Frankly, they do not deserve to be made into statuaries at all. But as long as we have them, let's properly take them down. Let's decide to take them down to communities which have jurisdiction, and then figure out what should be done with them. I'm going to be brief with these questions because I have so many from so many. I'm just going to be very specially brief. Now, here's one from Marge in Boston. She wants to know about Lucian Howe. That's H-O-W-E. Lucian Howe was a great ophthalmologist. The American Ophthalmology Society has named the Lucian Howe Medal in his honor. Harvard, I believe, has got a famous lab devoted to him. And so who is Lucian Howe? So Lucian Howe, let me get one of my books here. Lucian Howe I devoted an entire chapter to Lucian Howe in my book War Against the Weak, and we're talking about genocide as defined by the UN treaty, genocide committed by the American government and by the elite against many thousands of its citizens, by forced surgical sterilization, by confinement to internment camps called sanitariums, limiting marriage, marriage vetoing, segregation, etc. I have an entire chapter devoted to this guy, and it's called Blinded. It's chapter 8. Lucian Howe, who is now an honored ophthalmologist, was in favor of sterilizing everybody who wore glasses. This to cure the nation of vision problems. He also wanted the eugenical unfit to be to post a cash bond in case they would damage society, this cash bond to be delivered with their marriage license. He absolutely was a racist. The head of the Eugenics Research Association, and this is Lucian Howe. So if you're an ophthalmologist out there, or you know an ophthalmologist, ask him to look at the history of Lucian Howe, your most honored ophthalmologist, and see if this guy did not want to destroy many Americans to create a path toward a better country. Now we're going to talk, here's a note from someone else, and it is from Jeffrey in New York. I used to live in Minnesota. Tell me about the Vikings. All right, the Vikings are a famous football team, and they're revered, of course, and they are some of the most brutal and outrageous barbarians that ever walked the earth. They're able to conquer, pillage, rape, and burn many villages. I think for about 700 years, they plagued the English and Irish lands. And they did that so that they could take their wealth. And we have named a football team after these incredible barbarians. And of course, there are so many high schools and other things named Vikings. And for heaven's sakes, these were killers. These were mass murderers. Now, I understand completely that they advanced civilization with some of their techniques. But let me give you an example of what they did over 300 years of bloody raids in Great Britain. One of their leading their leaders was Ivar the Boneless, and he was one of the cruelest. He put, according to what's written, he put Edmund, the king of East Anglia, up against a tree and had his men shoot arrows at him until his head exploded. And Viking, one of his rivals, King Ella, was put to death in York by having his ribs cut at the spine. His ribs were broken, so they looked like wings, and his lungs were pulled out through the wounds in his back, and they called this the Blood Eagle. So that's who we've named the Vikings for. But if you want to change the name of the Vikings right after you change the name of the Redskins and the Indians, then you're also going to have to deal with the days of the week. What am I talking about? I'm talking about Sunday, which comes from, among other things, the Viking personification of the sun god, Suna. I'm talking about Monday, which comes from the north, from the Viking personification of the moon. I'm talking about Tuesday, which comes from the Viking god of dueling, Tuisdag. I'm talking about Wednesday, which is Woden's day, which is the main Viking god, Odin. I'm talking about Thursday, which is also known as Thor's day to those people. And this was named for Thor, the great Viking god with the hammer. Of course, now he's a movie character. And let's not forget Friday, which many scholars say is named for Freya, the alleged spouse of Thor. So that is the Vikings. Hope that answers your question, Jeffrey in New York. Susan in San Diego. Are the Democrats responsible for the persecution, slavery of African Americans? Yes. Democrats historically are the protectors of slavery. They are the originators of Jim Crow. They are the ones who placed segregation laws into place and defended segregation. They opposed civil rights. Woodrow Wilson was one of their ilk. The Ku Klux Klan depended upon them. And it is said that they have changed their tune in recent years. But the fact of the matter is the Democrats, now we're not talking politics now, we're only talking history, so I'm making no judge upon anyone now. But the Democrats historically have been the racist party, and the racist party that put racism into action with cruel laws, discrimination, prejudice, and terrible conditions for African Americans. Next one, Gerald in South Africa wants to know about the Washington Redskins and the Cleveland Indians. According to his question, which I'm just condensing, Gerald has repeated the often verbalized claim by the Redskins ownership that this is a noble name, that this is a complimentary name, that it's a name of honor for the for Indians. This is not the case. I did research on this. Adolf Hitler, very few people know, was a special fan of Western cowboy and Indians, Western movies, and Western novels. And Adolf Hitler himself personally referred to Indians by this denigrating name, Redskins. He referred to blacks as blackskins and reds as redskins. How in our nation's capital this could thrive for so long is totally beyond me. They could have called this group the Caps. They could have called them the Potomacs. They could have called them the Feds. They could have called them the G-Men. I don't care, whatever it is. But I will never, ever look at a Redskins game while they have that racist name. And don't tell me it's a name of honor. It's not. Change it, and change it fast. I know you're working on it, but you're only working on it because FedEx threatened you, and Nike threatened you, and they have the naming rights to the stadium, and they also have sales rights to many of your T-shirts and memorabilia. Now, as for the Cleveland in Indians, the Indians, of course, this is the wrong name ascribed to the Native American indigenous people, but they know who it is. It's the Indians. Why do we need to appropriate these people's names? Let's not call them the Indians. Let's call them the Cleveland Chinamen. Let's call them the Cleveland Jews. Let's call them the Cleveland Catholics, the Cleveland Lithuanians. Let's just take somebody's name and disregard their humanity and turn it into something that can be mocked. This is what I'm talking about. That name is coming down, and we'll see that soon. All right, here's a note from, I can't tell if this is Thomas or Thelma in Fort Lauderdale, probably Thomas. He wants to know about the American history of Natural Museum. I'm going to make a note here because, okay, the Natural Museum, the American Museum of Natural History, and I'm going to add to that the Bronx Zoo. Ladies and gentlemen, I will never respect this museum. This museum was guided in its early years by Madison Grant. Madison Grant was one of the leading figures of racism in the United States with his book, The Passing of the Great Race. He delineated the concept of the super race, the Nordic people, which was then transmogrified by Hitler into the Aryan people. And indeed, it was Hitler who wrote a fan letter to Madison Grant and said, "Your work is my Bible." This man, his institution, not to mention his colleagues who are also major eugenicists interested in wiping out 90% of mankind, these guys came into possession of a gentleman from Africa by the name of Otto Benga. And in 1906, Otto Benga was a slave. He was captured in Africa. He was brought to the United States like a piece of show equipment. He got into a tussle one day because he did not want to be confined in the museum. And so they put him in the Bronx Zoo. That's right, the Bronx Zoo that you know and love. He was placed in a cage. The famous monkey man, the ape man, a human being was placed in a monkey cage. And that's because the scientists of that day, led by Eugen Fischer, who was one of the leaders of the eugenics movement, and these leaders of the Museum of Natural History, thought that black people were baboons who could speak, speaking baboons. And that's why they put this man in a cage. Ultimately, he was released from that cage when the Harlem ministers objected. The New York Times defended his incarceration, but they finally got him out. And this was actually an educated man, a decent man. He ultimately committed suicide. But that is why I will never give a care, even though many of the people I work with care about the American Museum of Natural History. I will not. And if you think the Teddy Roosevelt statue with a Native American and a freed slave licking his boots is the biggest problem, that is just cosmetic compared to the damage that this organization and its leaders have done to the world. All right, let's go with another question. Here's a question about Carnegie and Carnegie Hall, Carnegie Library. It comes from Judy, and I cannot tell where she's from because she sent me an email. Thank you, Judy. I did get your email, and you want to know about Carnegie. Now, Carnegie was another criminal, and it was Carnegie. Let me see if I can find the information I've pulled on this guy. It was Carnegie who in 1889 was a member of the South Fork Fishing and Hunting Club. And it's because he was in this elite club that that had cultivated a dam that would, an earthen dam that would allow them easy access to the club and easy access to fishing, that dam had specifically not been fortified when they warned that heavy rains were coming. And that caused one of the worst floods in American history. About 2,000 lives were lost, not because of a natural disaster, but because Andrew Carnegie did not think that his carriage would fit on the wall of that earthen dam. If it were repaired, he did not want to be inconvenienced. He got so much bad press in the day that his PR machinery decided that he would start putting his name on works of art. He opened libraries everywhere, the Carnegie Library here, the Carnegie Library there. I came upon so many of so many of them. Carnegie Hall, he put his name on Carnegie Hall. True, it's been a gift to the world. I just want people to understand where the name comes from. And mainly, the Carnegie Institution financed the beginning of the eugenics movement and was responsible for creating the eugenics installation at Cold Spring Harbor in Long Island, which gave fake science and pseudoscience to the Nazis to enable them to create this mythology of eugenics and racial supremacy. All that's described in my book, War Against the Weak, which you can go up to Amazon. Don't worry, the money will just go to Jeff Bezos, but it's there, or you can get it in a library. And it was the Carnegie Institution that made it possible for all of this to take place. They were the building blocks. The last time I was up at Cold Spring Harbor to do a documentary, I saw the name of some of the main eugenicists, such as Davenport, still proudly showing on the buildings, Davenport Hall, parking lot, honorary status, Cold Spring Harbor. It still exists today, and it was established with a complete racist and genocidal purpose. Now, I know they've gone a long way toward making up for their misdeeds. They've got a wonderful website, but still, they've tried to profit off their archives, and they have a long way to go before they make up for what has been done. All right, our next question. Okay, here's a guy who wants to know about the space program, Wernher von Braun. Wernher von Braun, the man behind the Blitz, the man behind the Nazi rocket program, the man behind the terrible concentration camps next to Buchenwald, Peenemünde, these tunnels where people went in, they were worked to death and never came out. The guy behind the V1, the man who was aiming to destroy the United States with a long-range rocket. This man was picked up in Operation Paperclip. Operation Paperclip, everybody knows what it was. The gems of German science and German engineering were given clean slates. They were brought into the United States. Wernher von Braun was honored by Walt Disney, honored by NASA, honored by the United States. This was a cruel, heartless Nazi with blood on his hands. Okay, we want the space program. Absolutely. We want the benefits of his rocket technology. But let's understand who this man was, and watch our honors, watch the Hall of Fame, watch the inclusion, and understand that the world is a complex place. Now let's see what other names I have here. Here's a note from Simon in Arizona. I can't tell where in Arizona. He wants to know, was Thomas J. Watson of IBM a Nazi collaborator? To say that Thomas J. Watson was a Nazi collaborator would be the understatement of the century. Thomas Watson was a full partner with the Third Reich in organizing all six phases of the Holocaust: the identification of the Jews, their expulsion from society, the confiscation of their assets, the ghettoization, the deportation, and even the extermination of the Jews. He did all of this with the so-called Hollerith punch card, and the Hollerith punch card was the progenitor of the computer. He was already a convicted extortionist. Before he ever was hired by IBM, he was convicted in the famous NCR case, National Cash Register extortion case. He was described as a bandit by the judge. Ultimately, he got out of serving time on a technicality, and he is responsible for the death of millions of people. There was an IBM customer site. It's not just one man by itself. It was the IBM company. There was an IBM customer site in every concentration camp, and it's all written in great detail in my book, IBM and the Holocaust. There's over, I guess there's 1.4 or 5 million books in print in 190 countries in many languages, from Chinese to Hungarian. And why IBM would choose this monster, this psychopath, to name its new run the world, run your cities, run your life gizmo called Watson, I have no idea. And if you're an IBM attorney, I'm here for you, okay? It's been 20 years and you've never been able to deny a single fact since the book came out in February of 2001. All right, continuing on with these many questions, and we have lots of questions coming in. Wow, okay. I'll get to all these many questions. Here's another question. Did David Starr Jordan was the first president of Stanford University? Yes, Stanford University, the font of enlightenment. Their first president was David Starr Jordan, and it was David Starr Jordan who wrote the infamous book. Let's see what it was called. It was called in the late 19th century, Blood of the Nation, a study of the decay of races through the survival of the unfit. In 1891, he left in Indiana University to become the first president of Stanford. There are many many buildings and institutions named for this racist, and I understand the trustees of the University of Indiana are right now examining how to remove this man's name. Many of you will remember that it was the Nazi motto, Rassenblut, Rassenblut, race and blood. But race and blood, that phrase was not born in Munich. That was born in that was born decades before in the United States when the first president of Stanford University, David Starr Jordan, used it in his racial volume, The Blood of a Nation. Let's see what else we have here. I've got so many questions. I mean, it's a joy to get this many questions, but in point of fact, it's also a burden. I can't answer them all. Let me go to the questions which have just come in. From Michigan, can racism ever be eradicated? It would seem that it continues to be a human frailty, just like lust, envy, anger, and sloth. How can community or race relations be discussed without favoring one partisan group over another? Basically, we have to learn to respect other people. We have to be tolerant. It's true. It's true. You can be racially aware. It's true. You should be ethnically aware. I am ethnically aware when I meet an Indian person from subcontinental in India. I am ethnically aware when I go into an Indian restaurant, but I do not imagine in my mind or in my heart some nasty prejudice against Indians. And this is what we need to learn, and it must be learned from childhood. It really can't be unlearned except cosmetically. Thank you for that question. Let's see, we have a black president for two terms. We have a sitting Supreme Court justice who is black. This is from Michigan. There is a member of the cabinet who is black, a famed neurosurgeon. There are black people prominent in sports. How is it that there remain accusations that the U.S. is a realm of racism? Can anyone define systemic racism? That's inclusion. But inclusion is not the social surgery we need to remove the cancer of ill will within the body politic. And this we can't do because all our great leaders have been tolerating everything that I've been talking about, that everyone has been screaming about for decades. And now suddenly people are becoming slightly aware. So there's a lot to be done, a lot to be done. It needs to be done intelligently. It does not need to be done by mob. It needs to be done by education and by communication and opening the mind, opening the heart, and studying history. You don't have to be a student of history like I am, but pick up a book, see a documentary, get off your TikTok, look at the facts. Here's another question. Let's see, this is from Chicago, and someone wants to know if Hillary Clinton has praised as her mentor a former leader of the Ku Klux Klan. And the answer is Hillary Clinton has done that. The name of the Klan member, former Klan member, is former Senator Robert Byrd, B-Y-R-D. And Robert Byrd, in the 20s and 30s, had risen to the title of exalted cyclops of his local chapter. He spoke in favor of the Klan for many years. In 1946, he wrote a letter to the Imperial Wizard, quote, "The Klan is needed today as never before. I'm anxious to see its rebirth here in West Virginia." He tried to excuse himself and condemn his former conduct when he was running for the Senate. He was a leading figure of the Senate, a great constitutionalist, always carried the Constitution in his vest pocket, and he called it his greatest mistake. Even the NAACP praised him at his funeral. But it should be noted that in 2001, he gave an interview where he twice used the N-word. This was a national interview. And he said, quote, "My old mom told me, Robert, you can't go to heaven if you hate anybody. We practice that. There are white N-word. I've seen a lot of white N-word in my time. I'm going to use that word." This is him. "I'm going to use that N-word. We just need to work together to make our country a better country." So it's hard to make it a better country when you're still stuck in the N-word. So that is Robert Byrd, Klan member. In recent years, he tried to renounce his terrible activities, but it didn't stop Hillary Clinton from saying, "This is my mentor." You can probably see it on YouTube. She made an announcement. All right, let's get to another question. This is Alex from Long Island. Alex has a book out. I'm aware of this. It's Recipes from Auschwitz. "I understand that statues to Confederate heroes are offensive to descendants of slaves, just as statues to Nazi heroes are to Jews. Who should decide? A panel of historians without any political agenda?" Here's what I say about that. Before you ask me, what do I think about Confederate statues? Before you ask that question, ask me, what would I think about a statue 20 feet tall of Adolf Hitler, of Himmler, of Eichmann, of Goering, of Nazi leaders? What would I think about that? What does this Confederacy mean? These were not only traitors to the country, these were traitors to the Constitution and to mankind. These were people who insisted on maintaining a tradition of owning and torturing African-American slaves or descendants of slaves, even though importation had been outlawed in 1806, the descendants of those slaves were kept, they were reared, they one generation after another was raped to produce more slaves, and the country did in fact fight about slavery, but as I explained in a prior episode, Lincoln's Emancipation Proclamation made no effort to free all the slaves in the United States, just those who qualified as chattels under the 1862 Confiscation Act as a punishment for making war against the United States Federal Union. Now here's another question from, who should decide? A panel of historians? A panel of historians, you know, I try not to mix with a panel of historians because I know how easily they can be influenced by their foundation grants and all of that. But I would say historians would be important, but the decision must be made by the our own elected policymakers, whether it's city councils, whether it's boards of trustees, whether it's trustees of the corporations, et cetera, or the federal government. But we've got to take these down, and we got to take them down now. And we should not allow the mob to take down statues of Confederates that belong to other people, commit violence, and in the process, take down a statue of Frederick Douglass, of Gandhi, and of other good men simply because they don't know how to distinguish the aspects of history. Let's go to another one. All right, so I think I have one more, and the answer is, this will be our last question, and the answer is, what can you say about history? That's a tough one. Comes from New York, from Mark. All right, Mark, here's the story on what history is. History is like an individual. The individual can do bad things, repent, and do good things. Amazing Grace, which is sung as a kind of a symbol of freedom for the slaves and spiritual nourishment. Amazing Grace was written by a slave ship captain. So we have to look at the whole picture, the full history. Yes, when you get to someone like Wilson, when you get to someone like Churchill, it's nuanced. When you get to someone like Thomas Jefferson, it's nuanced. When you get to someone like George Washington, it's nuanced. When it comes to the Confederate, when it comes to Nazi figures, there's no room for nuance because they committed the cardinal sins and they in fact engaged in nightmare activities against mankind. All right, we've gone about as far as we can go. We're out of time. I'll see you next week at 3 p.m. Eastern. Till then, get yourself to any Barnes & Noble in the USA or any Amazon platform in 190 countries across the planet where you can find any of my books, 200 editions. I'd be apropos of today's discussion, IBM and the Holocaust, War Against the Weak. I've got a thin one called Nazi Nexus, which cuts across the five worst corporations. Get your passwords and access to participate live in future shows at theedwinblackshow.com. And you'll see a much enhanced and produced version of this show, along with prior episodes, by subscribing to our YouTube channel at The Edwin Black Show. Be sure to click on the notification button. Follow me at the Edwin Black Book at Twitter and Facebook. You're not going to see anything affront of there. And if you want to join our group and be part of our intellectual team, you can email us at jointheteam@theedwinblackshow.com. Thank you very much. I'm closing the show, zooming out.